who's going to end up being poked or otherwise.
Is there any evidence? There is, I count 7 or 8 states anyway that have some variation of the reasonable suspicion rule like what they want, roughly. Is there any evidence at all that in those 7 or 8 states there is more contraband being smuggled in?
Well, there is a testimony in the record from their expert who said that in Kentucky there is today the single biggest problem in Kentucky prisons and the biggest cause of death is drug overdose, which suggests that there's a serious contraband issue in Kentucky. Kentucky is in one of those, is inside one of the circuits that's had a reasonable suspicion requirement as a constitutional matter forever. So I would say there, yes, there is some evidence from which you could infer that it's worse now than it was. But I would also ask the court to rely on its common sense and its own, and what it essentially took judicial notice of in Bell versus Wolfish and Rutherford versus Block, which is this is a serious problem, and it is no less a serious problem today than it was more than 30 years ago.
Are there any limits? Are there any constitutional limits in your view? You say you didn't attempt the kind of search that was done in Bell v. Wolfish. Is there any constitutional impediment to your doing so?
I don't believe that. My position would be no, there isn't a constitutional
that
the balance would tip in favor of the institution under those circumstances. I do think, obviously, there is a limit between a manual physical body cavity search. And that, it seems to me, yes, that would be a very different balance of the equation. And I suspect I would be very hard-pressed to just to convince 5 members of this court that that's
you want us to write an opinion that applies only to squatting and coughing. Is that it?
Well, you may want to write it slightly differently.
Yeah.
But what I would really like is an opinion that recognizes that deference to the prison and to their judgment is what's appropriate under these circumstances, and that extends all the way to the Bell versus Wolfish line. The only difference being that I would like for the court to analyze it under Turner versus Safley, in which the analysis is this, you know, is there a logical nexus between the rule that the prisons have and preventing a problem? And the answer is yes. And are there reasonable alternatives? And there the answer is no.
So you are saying that they can do the full, as far as the Constitution is concerned. All of these searches are permissible.
Clearly, all of our searches are permissible,
no,
and I would go
Bell
all this, and Bell versus Boy. Yeah, I think that's exactly the holding of Bell versus Wolfish. Bell versus Wolfish was not tied in its opinion itself to the fact that
they did stress that there was a visitor who could give the inmate contraband. Bell v. Wolfish doesn't, and I asked Mr. Goldstein whether we know whether pretrial detainees in New York were searched that way on entry. And he said there's nothing that shows one way or the other.
Right. I think that's correct. We don't know. And of course, part of the empirical problem in that is that facility only been open for 4 months anyway. So it was really going to be difficult if you were going to adopt the policy that they'd adopted in Bell to insist on some sort of empirical proof.
But one significant difference between Bell and this case is that in Bell there was a real opportunity for people to plan, to conspire together to bring in contraband. Here you're talking about somebody who's arrested on the spot. There's no opportunity for planning, for conspiracy with respect to contraband, is there?
No, but the policy itself, may I answer the question? The policy is aimed at all people, not just at Mr. Florence. And if you aim it at all people, there are people who self-report, who've obviously got an opportunity to bring in contraband. And there are a lot of people who just get arrested and happen to have drugs or something on them, and rather than show those when they're being stopped for a speeding ticket, will likely stick it in their pocket or put it somewhere else. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Counsel. Ms. Saharsky.
Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the Court, the searches at issue in Bell are very similar to the searches at issue in this case, and they should be upheld. I want to start with Justice Kagan's question. It is true that contact visits in Bell are different from a person coming in to the jail for the first time, in that there might be a greater opportunity for planning. But as one of the justices pointed out, there was less of an opportunity to actually get contraband. The person coming in was going to be searched. The inmate, as Justice Marshall pointed out, was wearing a one-piece zip-up jumper, and he's being watched the entire time. The contraband situation in this case at intake, the person does have an opportunity, even if they are not self-reporting, knowing that they're going to be arrested. Protesters, for example, who decide deliberately to get arrested, they might be stopped by the police. They see the squad car behind them. They might have a gun or contraband in their car and think, hey, I'm going to put that on my person. I just need to get it somewhere that's not going to be found during a pat-down search, and then potentially they have the contraband with them. Also, the process of going from the arrest, point of arrest, to the general jail population is not a quick one. The person typically goes, for example, to a metropolitan police department. That's what happens here. And the person would mix potentially there in a holding cell with other offenders. If this court, for example, adopted a rule saying that minor offenders would not be searched in a way that other offenders would, I have no doubt that there are some offenders in those circumstances all on the bus together to go to the general jail population who would give the stuff to the minor
then
offenders.
Then how does that differ? That's not the federal rule. And by the way, the brief was really confusing because when I read page one tells me that the BOP policy requires all incoming pretrial detainees to be subject to visual body cavity inspections. And then it isn't until page 30 that I learned there is an exception for the very category of arrestee that we're talking about here, that they are not subject to body cavity inspections unless there's reasonable suspicion that they're concealing contraband, that the misdemeanor or civil contempt offender is not subject.
I'm sorry if that was confusing. The Bureau of Prisons policy is that a person will not be put in the general population being allowed to mix with other offenders unless he or she has undergone the strip search.
Yes, but I want to know how people in this category are treated in the federal system. And you reversed it. Those people are not subject to this visual body cavity search.
Those people, when they go into the jail, would be asked whether they're willing to consent to this type of search. In most cases, they do consent. If they don't consent and there is not reasonable suspicion, then they are not placed in the general jail population. They are kept separate from the other offenders. So it is the case, the rule that the Third Circuit identified, which is a blanket policy that anyone that's going to go into the general jail population and mix with everyone else has to be strip searched, that is the Federal Bureau of Prisons policy.
I'm sorry, I'm sure I missed something. You say when they go in, they're asked, will you consent to a more intrusive body cavity search and be put into the general population? Or if you don't, you don't have to be searched and we put you in someplace else. Who consents to that?
Well, the general jail population has certain facilities, you know, computer facilities and others that you don't get when you're in a cell by yourselves. As a practical matter, this arises very, very infrequently in the federal system. We're talking about fewer than 1% of offenders. And the question before the court at this point really is, you have before you a blanket policy saying we need to strip search everyone, and is that something that's unreasonable or irrational in the way that the court has considered its normal deference to prison officials? And
I understand most of the general proposition that your side is advancing. But I have to say I was somewhat surprised at the evidence of the amount of contraband that was discovered, or the amount of weapons that was discovered that's in the literature and that's in the citations was somewhat skimpy. I thought there would be a stronger showing than I found in the briefs.
Well, there are not empirical studies of this type of information. Typically, it arises when there are incidents at a facility and incident reports are written up. They're not published regularly. There's not some kind of laboratory study that you can do. The facilities have an incident they try to deal with. Sometimes it makes the news. Those are some of the things that we've reported. And I would hate for the court to think that there is not evidence of people who've committed minor offenders in the record bringing in very serious things into prisons and jails. I'd point you to footnote 15 in the government's brief, which talks about people being arrested for traffic offenses and smuggling crack pipes in body cavities. I'd point the court to both experts in this case, cited by Mr. Phillips. I'd point the court to the record in Bull, the San Francisco case.
The issue has to be certainly some misdemeanor
some people charged with misdemeanor crimes will try to smuggle things in. The issue is how many of them would not have been found on a reasonable suspicion standard. I think Justice Breyer said in the San Francisco study, it appears only one.
I think that that's a very hazardous thing for courts to do with 20/20 hindsight. You know, the court could look back at individual offenders and find out information.
Well, we don't have 20/20. We have how many years, 15 years since Bell, where prisons have been applying the reasonable suspicion standard, and the most you can muster under that standard is one example of a case where someone has entered. At some point, empirical evidence has to mean something in terms of us judging the question of reasonableness.
I agree with you, but what I'm saying is that the individuals who are doing the searches at issue have very limited information about people. This is when you have people who are coming into the system for the first time. They have had the most contact with the outside world. You have the least amount of information about them.
Well,
in the federal
system, I do have a question about that today. I know that when it's bad to base your judgments on your own personal experiences. When I was a prosecutor, it took sometimes days to get a rap sheet. I understand that that's no longer the case today, that they're virtually almost always accessible by computers today.
That may be true, but it's not the information that the people who do intake and are doing the searches have. They do not have that information at their fingertips in the federal system. They have name, date of birth, and they have the offense that the person was charged with. They don't know anything else. And the question before the court, if I may, is whether there are reasons for a blanket rule that this court should defer to. And I would say there are several. First of all, you cannot say that there are some minor offenders that don't pose a contraband risk. They are documented in the record. Second, you have individuals who are making very quick determinations. They have a large numbers of people to get through into the general prison population. They have very little time, and if they guess wrong, those mistakes can be deadly. Third, the rule needs to be...
Suppose we accept the petitioner's concession that it is permissible to require everybody who is arrested to disrobe and shower under the observation of a corrections officer from a certain distance. Now the question would become, how many people who do that will still be able to smuggle in contraband?
Well, there would be contraband found in body cavities, and we have documented in this record and other records in our brief that there are folks who do that, and that contraband is not found until they do these
procedures. That's my problem. I don't know. I overstated the strength of your evidence. I was just trying to draw it out, or I understated it. San Francisco's point is really that 30-60% or some very high percentage of people who come in for minor crimes are high on drugs or have been there's just that footnote, really, which has a few examples. Definitely they're there in this category. So would it be helpful if you included in the excluded part people who are high on drugs? You see, so we give you the high on drugs people. It's the drug offense and those who are high on drugs and those, is there a way of drawing this rule that we can catch most of the people in footnote?
I think the fundamental question for the court is who's supposed to be doing this line drawing? And you've said in case after case after case, they're going to defer to the prison and jail officials who are seeing this stuff on the ground.
But it's obvious that the simplest thing for any prison official is say, do it for everybody. And so the fact they do it for everybody and don't try to make some exclusion for traffic violators or something might be consistent with little or no evidence and might be consistent with some. That's why I keep looking.
There are many good reasons, though, to have a policy to do it for everyone. It is easy to administer when you have lots of people. It is done for the protection of people like petitioners.
What is the reason, if there's so much sense to that policy, why isn't it the federal policy? Before you said because there aren't that many offenders. If there were more, then would there be would the federal policy change so that even people who are in on a contempt charge or a minor crime?
Yes, the federal government thinks that blanket policy is a good one. It made one modification to its policy in 2003 when the weight of the circuits was against it. But again, this is a policy that is done for everyone's protection. A point that Justice Kennedy made earlier is
I'm sorry, I didn't understand. You think the Fed think it's a good policy to inspect everyone?
Yes, to inspect everyone who would be put in the general jail population. That is the Third Circuit's holding, and that's what we're defending in this case. That's because when you have a rule that treats everyone the same, you don't have folks that are singled out. You don't have any security gaps. We urge you to affirm the judgment of the court below.
Thank you, counsel.
Mr. Goldstein, take 4 minutes.
Thank you, sir. I have 3 points to make. The first is that my friend from the United States says defer to the experts, but the point that the United States consistently omits is that there are 600,000 offenders that go into the federal system every year. I don't understand the claim that this only involves 1% of federal offenders. The Marshal Service and ICE admit 600,000 offenders every year under our standard. They are not kept in separate housing. These are cited in our brief. 600,000 people, is their expert judgment, are subject to a reasonable suspicion standard when they're admitted to jail. The second point about numbers, Justice Breyer, there is a significant empirical study, and that is the County of Orange case. The district judge there did an unbelievably detailed job going through the record of 26,000 admissions into the system and was able to identify only a single instance where contraband would have gotten in under a reasonable suspicion standard. There is also evidence in this case, and it is the evidence, to my surprise, that my friends keep pointing to. There's a memorandum from the Essex jail system. It's at page 70A to 71A of the joint appendix. And it tells you two really relevant things. It says every year they admit 25,175 people into this jail, and that they only found 14 instances of contraband. And they don't even make the claim that those 14 instances out of 25,000 would not have been found under a reasonable suspicion standard. So you have evidence in this record about this particular case. Third, a couple of points have been made about whether, Justice Breyer, you asked whether someone who's high on drugs, the uniform rule, and this is not just the ABA, but the expert standard of the American Correctional Association, what they say is that essentially almost anything will do. What will not amount to reasonable suspicion is when you have a minor offender, and we do have, there's 700,000 people in jail in the United States every year for misdemeanor offenses. This is a lot of people who are having a very significant intrusion on privacy. And the expert standard, the rule that was applied under Bell versus Wolfish, is that when you have people who come in on a minor offense, they don't have any drug history. They're not high on drugs. There was no opportunity to hide a weapon. I'm not sure where they think the gun is going to be hidden that's not going to show up in the very close manual pat-down that they do of every one of these people that isn't going to show up in.
I don't think you're really arguing for an individualized reasonable suspicion standard. I think you're arguing for a rule that draws distinctions based on categories that correspond only perhaps very roughly to reasonable suspicion.
Well, first, there are real categories that are over-inclusive in favor of the jails, like if it's a serious offense or they have any drug history. And then on top of that, if there's any individualized basis that the jails can articulate, that will do as well. We are not saying that categorically people will be excluded from being searched. We're saying that there are entire categories that will automatically be searchable. We're just saying don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. When somebody is pulled over like Mr. Florence, and there's just, it's laugh-out-loud funny to think that he's smuggling something into this jail, that it's too much of an intrusion to put him under the direct, 2 feet away, I'm going to look at your genitals, as opposed to the ordinary intrusion of saying we're going to oversee the showers. There is no evidence when it comes to that group of people, and there are a lot of them, that they represent anything like a material threat of smuggling, and this is a very significant intrusion on individual privacy and individual dignity. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. The case is submitted.